Child Stand and Children's March to Victory, 1963.
Are you asking me about the Children's March?
Well, let me tell you. The year was 1963, and it was one heck of a year. There I was, a 9-year-old in a jail cell. Would you believe it? Day 6, 1963. You must be wondering what me, 9-year-old Audrey Faye Hendricks, is doing in a jail cell with hundreds of others. Well, let me tell you, I was born into it. My parents are both civil rights activists, and I guess it rubbed off on me. They've been protesting for years and years to build me and Jan, my sister, a safer world. Here in Birmingham, Alabama, there have been 60 unsolved bombings, which means the police don't even know who did it. There have been so many, our city is called Bombingham. But we kept on speaking up, trying to get something done. We were all so scared, because so many grown-ups, including Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., were placed in jail for protesting for us. In fact, Dr. King was placed in solitary confinement. He was all alone and couldn't even talk to anybody. But we had no choice, because we would never be equal. We had separate bathrooms, separate places to eat, and all of us blacks felt like a little ant about to be squashed. Ever since I was a child, I attended meetings at our church to follow my parents' footsteps and change Bombingham for good. Now, my parents may be activists, but they're not the big reason why I'm here. First in our city, there's Project C, which was when the adults did the same thing we were doing. They marched from our church downtown on 16th Street right into jail. Now, they may have been arrested, but there sure weren't as many of them as there were of us. You see, most of them didn't want to lose their jobs, so most of them didn't show up. And it really wasn't as successful as Dr. King had hoped. But we kids came on a mission, and you know why we succeeded? Because the police, they didn't see us coming. When Reverend James Bevel, he makes speeches at our church sometimes, when he told Dr. King that the kids should march, Dr. King was nervous, because he thought us kids would be hurt in the march. But in the end, it was Bevel who organized our march and taught us how to create nonviolent chaos. He taught us not to fight back, and as Dr. King says, nonviolence is the strongest support. Day of the march, I wasn't too nervous or scared because my parents had my back. You see, Dr. King was a frequent visitor at our house and discussed his plans with Mama, so my parents knew what I was getting into. It was May 2nd, 5 days ago, and we called it D-Day. All of us kids who went to school that morning knew tomorrow we probably wouldn't be back at school. Kids walked right in front and right out back without even stopping in their classrooms. When I got to church, where all the kids were meeting, I looked around and saw thousands and thousands of kids just like me ready to be arrested. When the doors of the church opened, we were sent out in groups, and with each group coming through the front, even more were coming in the back. It was a giant flood of kids, but the police, they were there waiting. Now, the march. Our plan was to march from our church on 16th Street right to City Hall, where all the whites could hear our message, and we had one common goal, fill up the jail cells. We put all of our nonviolent training to good use and sent a message to all the segregationists who could hear us. There were so many of us kids that guess what? Bull Connor, he's the commissioner of public safety, had to bring in our school buses to haul us to jail because the police didn't even have enough police cars. And you know what upset the police the most? Instead of being angry or scared that we were being arrested, we were singing our heads off. And the police just about wanted to kill us. They knew if they killed a bunch of singing kids, they would sure lose their reputation. And one of the songs was one we sang in church, and I sang until my face was hurting from singing so much. When I got to jail, I heard officers talking, saying hundreds of kids were being arrested, and I took great pride in being in jail, until I got homesick. My cell was cold and damp, and hundreds of kids were stuffed in cells only meant for 50 people. Yeah, I had fun singing, but my stomach was always grumbling, and I didn't have a change of clothes. Over there, that's a girl who sits with me at school, and she gotta go to the bathroom, but she gotta share with all the other girls that gotta go, and I don't wanna think about it if she can't hold it anymore. And an old girl from church over there, she looks sick. I hope she doesn't throw up, because if she does, I might too. Plus, we're only allowed outside in a concrete area. Day 2 of the march, we called it Double D-Day, and from what I could hear, it was quite a hassle. I heard that around 3,000 people watched the march, and can you guess the craziest thing? Kids from even outside our city marched with kids from Birmingham. Around 2,000 people arrested from what I could hear, and it sounded like a heck of a lot of fun. That was until I heard about the hoses. According to some older girls who came into jail wet, firemen came out with hoses at full blast to make them stop protesting. Kids were shot across pavement, pinned to brick walls, and the worst part was, the water was aimed at their heads. and dogs were also bred out, but not the cute kind. Dogs trained to bite and attack anyone crossing their path. They ripped holes in people's sweaters, cut kids' skin wide open, and sent some running back. But no matter what, kids kept on coming, and so marchers were arrested, freed, and arrested again. And soon enough, cells were too full for anyone else, and kids were being put in the jail yard, which was a problem when it started to rain. Now, you may not believe me when I tell you this, but day three, marchers were still lining up to be put in jail. I heard some brave older kids even came out in bathing suits to show the police no water was going to stop them. If I were in a bathing suit, I bet you my skin would be torn apart. But no matter what, us kids, we overcame it all. We were singing and marching for three whole days to get freedom. And you know what I hope? I hope this march will have made a difference. And whether it's in 20 years or tomorrow, I just want equal rights and a chance to be equal. I remember the children's march like it was yesterday. I stayed in that filthy cell for six whole days and nights. What still amazes me is even after I was released from jail and went back to school, nobody stopped to ask me about my time in jail. Life went on as if nothing had happened and I was just a normal kid like everyone else. But something had happened after that courageous march. Now, I didn't realize this as a child, but now I know that we were the unacknowledged heroes of our time. It was only on May 10th, a few days after I was released from jail, that an agreement was reached between James Bevel, Dr. King, and Eugene Conner. And after 4,000 arrests in the Children's March, Conner was finally voted out of office, and Birmingham was on its way to being equal. Later that year, on June 11th, 1963, Kennedy came on our little black and white television and said something I'll never forget. He said it ought to be possible, in short, for every man to enjoy the privileges of being American, and in short, every American ought to have the right to be treated as one would wish to be treated, as one would wish his children to be treated. Nowadays, equality is still a right people are fighting for, but I believe the message of equality we spread back in 63 is as powerful as any march to date. We show no matter how small, anyone can make a difference, and those who stay true to their sense of equal rights have the best chances of success. Now, all of us kids in the Children's March, including myself, were determined to create an integrated America. And although the United States is far from equal rights for all, we must continue to fight for what we know is right and remain nonviolent in all of our efforts. I know as long as I live, I'll remember the Children's March. Heck, I still remember the song I sang in hopes of a greater future. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, gonna keep on a walking, keep on a talking, gonna build a brand new world.